school has a policy. I'm going to give you all these. Is your personal email address drpamvogel@gmail.com?
It is.
Here's the school policy on personal email saying that they're available, that they are subject to FOI.
This is an exhibit?
Yes, please.
And there's emails attached to that. Was that intentional?
Yes. Yes,
yes.
It is. Item number one.
Well, before we go further, so we have guidelines for email usage, and are you familiar with that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then we have email. Using in one iteration, Gmail and another. Could I just do a slide here?
Mm-hmm. Sure. Yes.
What is this document? It seems to have. Is this a part of an email trail?
This was a document provided by Dr. Vogel within that particular FOI request that was completed. The one that goes February 23rd through March 15th.
What has happened? May I answer?
Dr. Vogel explain the witness that she received, complainant that she received this document, and just so that we can all understand what it is, may the witness explain?
Yes.
Thank you.
Sometimes I have both emails. My board members have both emails, and occasionally they will send it to my personal by mistake. Just yesterday I received a personal email from teacher. It was not of a personal nature. I don't know why they didn't use my school email, but that does happen occasionally, not very often.
Could you just explain how on the same email trail we have you using two different emails?
And this is, I'm not sure who this is from.
May I ask the complainant, is this an excerpt from more than one page of responsive records? Because it seems incomplete.
Oh, I can tell you why this is. The person that this went to is not related to the school. This is a personal friend who would have had only my personal email. She was involved in the conversation at the time with about the scheduling. This was some time ago. But when I responded back to the other person who was involved, I used my school email.
I can say that this is a document that was received in this FOI. Exactly.
May I ask further, was there anything in front of this? Because it just seems incomplete. Typically, an email file starts with a header and then goes in reverse chronological order.
Yeah, we're not. That would have happened when I was mentioning
something. Okay. I question the relevance of this.
What is the purpose of offering this?
The school policy states that the personal emails are part of FOI.
Mm-hmm.
Yet, and Dr. Vogel has just stated that every once in a while she gets an email from a board member.
Mm-hmm.
Within this completed FOI request, this was the only reference to Dr. Vogel's personal Gmail account. So my question is, did you receive any emails between February 23rd through March 15th from anyone on this list through your personal email?
Everything that you requested was printed, and that... The reason that you have that one is because that's a personal friend who was involved, and so I responded then to the board chair with my school email explaining her email.
But my question was, were there any emails between February 23rd and March 15th, 2017, in your personal email account that you did not include in satisfying the FOI request?
May I question you?
She can answer the question. I think the question is, did you search your personal emails for responsive records?
I asked the technology person to get everything, and everything was produced.
Including your personal, your Gmail account?
I assume he did.
I'm sorry.
In fact, I did ask him.
So it's your understanding that he did also search your personal email account?
I asked him if he could get everything. He said, I don't have access to your personal email.
Did you search your personal email account?
I don't use my personal email for school. The email there to Mary is not a school person.
So the email that is part of what the complainant handed me that is undated and has your Gmail, which is your personal account, that email does not pertain to school business? Is that what you're saying?
She's a personal friend. She is on the Board of Finance.
Yeah.
She was wanting to speak with me and the first selectman to try to settle the waters. And so when I responded to the board chair, I used my regular email to state what she had said.
I'm going to just ask you another way. I think you've testified that you did not search your personal Gmail account for records that would be responsive to this FOI request, these FOID requests, correct?
Did I do the search? I didn't do the search. I asked the technology coordinator to do the search.
And if I understand your testimony correctly, that person informed you that he didn't have access to
yes.
your Gmail account. So my question again is, did you search? You obviously have access to your own Gmail account. Did you search your Gmail account for responsive records?
I don't use my Gmail account at home generally for anything with board members or administrators.
Right, but again, I note that you use the word generally, you don't, but that leaves open the possibility that perhaps you did. So is your testimony that you did not search for your...
I did not search.
Okay. Thank you.
Usually the only time that I have friends that are administrators and I might invite them to dinner. Other than that, no, I don't use my personal email.
So when you qualify your prior testimony that generally you don't, are you testifying now that the instances in which you have used your personal account are limited to social invitations
personal,
to meet
yes.
you and people who happen to be members of the school community?
And that's, I don't usually, it might be the assistant superintendent for social occasion.
May I just, because I think it's important that the record be clear and correct.
Yeah, please.
Dr. Vogel, the scope of the Freedom of Information Law is very broad. And even if a person has no official responsibility, if you're communicating about activities of the Region 1 public schools, that would be a public record because it relates to the conduct of the public agency, even if the recipient is not an official, such as Mary, for example. And when we look at the email from Mary, I don't understand it completely, but Mr. Whalen is the chair of the Region 1 Board of Ed. There's reference to Sharon Parents, the Sharon Board meeting agenda to talk about the schedule. So unless I'm mistaken, that would be related to board business, even though Mary is not a public official. And in responding to the hearing officer's questions, I was just concerned that you were perhaps drawing a distinction between official board business and what are public records. And does that explanation help clarify that you may have emails on your personal account that relate to board business and therefore, even though not official, but that therefore are public records as defined by the Freedom of Information Law?
There could be a couple of like that, but only because she was involved in that particular time.
And are you willing to search your personal email for emails that relate to the activities of the Region 1 public schools, and by that I mean the 7
mm-hmm.
school district?
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Yes.
I hope that's helpful.
Thank you.
Well, you'd be searching, you'd be asking the other members that are
indicated
in the FOI.
I'm sorry, I'm not understanding.
The FOI asks for Bob Whalen, the whole list of people from February 23rd to March 17th. Have they been asked to search their personal emails as well?
Have they been asked to search their personal emails?
Yes.
Did you ask them to search their personal email accounts?
No, I did not.
So your email is not been checked, and so no emails from your personal email, Dr. Pam Blumel, at Gmail, were included in the documents that you provided for that FOI request?
No, because I did not think that there were any.
Let's get back to this exhibit. I don't think I need this, but I would mark this if there's no objection.
No objection.
So that is complainant H. I said H.
On the redacted documents that you provided just now, this packet here,
no, go ahead.
Oh, on this packet that we all received a copy of with the redacted and unredacted pages,
that would be respondents four.
Maybe I am just not seeing it. But I see this page. This particular page is the redaction, but am I just not seeing the one that's unredacted?
We can take a moment and look, given going back electronically and recovering the email so that the original could be disclosed without redaction, the formatting changed some, and with the hearing officer's agreement, Attorney Wagner, who prepared this document, can answer your question.
That's great. While she's looking for that tonight, that anything that is in this packet that you gave me will be the redacted version and the unredacted version.
Yes.
May I respond with a clarification about in response?
Yeah.
So if you look at the redacted one and you turn the page, it's incomplete. It starts at the bottom. So it is not a full, do you see it at the bottom? It says for,
yeah.
So I think
we're talking about
yeah.
This,
right. So Dr. Vogel, could we work to get the remainder of this email. This one right here.
Do I have a copy of this?
I mean, I have the whole email. I'm not quite sure why I have it. And yep. Don't. Oh, I'm sorry. No, I thought we were on the first page. Okay, so
a few pages in.
Okay. And then what your point?
We don't have the complete.
Yeah, we
unredacted.
Don't. That's right.
Okay, so following this page, there should have been an unredacted page?
Yes.
Right.
And there's not?
There's not. It starts down here. I think what happened, Jonathan, is this. It's not complete. The rest of it's not there.
Oh, I see.
Mm-hmm. Right, you know which email it is?
Yep. I know Gmail.
How will agency copies of the ones that are not included if there's any more? That's the one that sent out. Can we get those emailed? Or?
They can be promptly emailed as soon as we track them down. Is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, they should all be there. That one was incomplete. But otherwise, they should all, I mean, that one's represented, but it's not complete. But all of the emails that were redacted, that upon review we determined should not have been redacted, we have provided, but for the fact that that one was partially provided.
Rather than have to go through each one now, which time can I take a look at this later and if there's anything else within this email and looking at
We have no objection.
This is an email that was in a parent last year, Davis Carson, sent an FOI to support parents. And there's an overlap in the emails that she requested and Jessica requested. And this particular email was in Dana Scarpa's, but was not included in the packet that you provided to Jessica. So my concern is that there are missing emails.
You'll have to share the information because we don't know what you're referring to.
I know there was a lot of contention with this email because
Can you explain again what you just said?
This email was part of Dana Scarpa's FOI request to Patricia Chamberlain, who was the previous superintendent last year. Mm-hmm. It overlaps your time frame of February 23rd through March 15th. This particular email was not included in the documents you provided.
I honestly can't. I've never seen this.
Is this responsive to Ms. Stedman's FOI request?
Yes.
Well, I'm not asking you. Oh, I'm asking the superintendent.
So you're saying this was in a packet for whom?
Dana Scarpa. With FOI request last year.
With Trish, okay.
There's an overlap of the time period of her request and Jessica's. She received this email as part of the packet. It's within this time frame.
Well, I think the difference is I'm not on this at all. This is between Bob and Andrea and Jonathan. I'm not listed, and I've never seen this email before.
Jessica's request is not the email that was sent to you. Both of the emails that we got were not with you. It's between board members.
I've not seen this email ever before.
You can't answer why it wouldn't have come
no,
up
I
in
cannot.
The subsequent search.
No, I cannot.
In Ms. Stedman's case.
And are we referring to the request for the period February 23rd through March 15th,
yes.
2017? And it's your testimony that this email was provided to someone else at some other time, but it wasn't provided to you, to Ms. Stedman, pursuant to the request we've just identified.
That is correct. I don't know that there aren't more like this. I just know this one because I had seen it. It was a hot topic. My concern is that the FOI request is not complete. This is the same email address, argonandoriginal.org, Jonathan Moore, Andrew Downs, we have hundreds of emails from Robert Brown and Henry Downs and Jonathan Moore, but this one specifically was not there, and Dr. Vogel has just testified that she has never seen this email before.
Make a suggestion?
Sure.
Given the fact that this is a legitimate question on its face, but we're not in a position to understand how the IT person went about the search, and we would want to be sure that there was not a misunderstanding of the scope of the search, we would offer to review this matter with the IT person who gathered the information that the superintendent examined and respond in writing to Ms. Stedman as to what that investigation shows.
Have the IT person respond directly to Ms. Stedman or to have Dr. Vogel respond to her? What do you think?
I'm fine with either one. The IT person told me he did a very thorough search.
But it probably would be helpful for you to have a better understanding of what terms he used, right, rather than just rely on his conclusion that he did a thorough search.
Well, I gave him the FOIs. And he knew
you
all
gave the requests.
Yes, and he knew all the names of the persons and the dates.
So you're presuming that he used their names and their date and the dates.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think it would be helpful to, you know, quiz this person a little bit on what search terms were used and how he or she went about doing the search, and either whoever might be the more articulate person, draft a summary of that in a letter to Ms. Studman.
That would probably be the IT person.
Yeah, I'm just, in all candor, want to make sure that there was no misunderstanding and that there weren't, in the search algorithm, connections that if they weren't there, that wouldn't show up. It's A and B or C, but if you don't have A or B, then it wouldn't show up. I don't suspect that's the case, and given the volume of the documents, who knows, but that would be my justification for wanting to know so that we are assured that our methodology was appropriate to the request.
Attorney Mooney, do you have an objection to me marking this email as okay, and that would be H, or do we already have an H?
We have an H.
Unless
it's this, oh no.
No, we do. It's just going to write it down. Hold on. Here we go. Here's H. Let me put H down first, and then we will do I for this present email. So let's see. H was. Okay, that is I, and I'm going to mark that. You can proceed.
Before I ask my next question, just a suggestion. I know we both just when I suggested to Dr. Vogel, when we talk to your IT person, tell them to group by conversation. The entire conversation will show up on one page. And I had to redact all this because it's about a student. But for example, this teacher at the high school asked a question, and all of these teachers replied
to the question.
It's all on one thing. I have to do group by conversation, and you'll save yourself at least
1,000
names.
I can't answer that. I don't know.
Yeah, it's above my pay
grade. I mean, this is from the high school email system. You just click on group by conversation, and the question and all the replies to it, as Jessica and I both responded to you, that's what we're looking for.
Can you tell us what the emails would look like if you don't group by conversation?
You have to go through every single person's email box.
Right. I think that's typically...
Every single one.
I think that's what they generally, in the 12 years that I've been here, that's kind of how the searches are done.
If you group by conversation... Well, let me go back a sec. I had stated, and I can't suggest this if I can share, what we're looking for is if Bob sends an email out to all six board members and three reply. We're looking for the email sent and the three replies.
Yeah, but that's not what the request was. So that's sort of on the requester. What this complainant asked for was would have required a search of every single person's email, in and out. I mean, that's very different from what it sounds like you're asking for. So that's something you can keep in mind for the future.
No. It's a technical issue. We're asking for the same amount of information, just that Gmail will gather them so that they're in group of conversation and save about 1,000 pages in a printer.
So let me say it a different way. Yeah, it is on Gmail. Is the on behalf of the complainant, are you saying that as we go forward and completing the response, that if the IT person can follow this practice of grouping by conversation, that would be acceptable?
Okay.
Would it meet the request?
Well, that's what we've just clarified on the record. Yes, it would. And in fact, I think the complainant prefers it because it's less to review.
I can't say. I honestly don't know.
All we want to know is if we can do it, is that acceptable? The answer is yes, and now we'll find out if we can do it.
It's called group by conversation.
Yes, I got that.
Question on attachments. With most of the emails, not all, but most of them, when there's an attachment, we get a copy of the attachment. But there are some that we do not. Is there a reason why some we get the attachment and some we do not?
Actually, I think there were a number that the attachment doesn't come automatically, it just shows us an attachment.
Okay. Yeah, for example, if I receive an email with an attachment and I respond, it's going to show that there was an attachment, but there won't be an attachment because I didn't attach it.
If you receive an email that has an attachment on it, sometimes that attachment is printed as part of the FOI packet. Very often it's not. I think the FOI request is requesting an attachment
because
it's part of the email.
I actually think, Denise, that the attachments are not included in those FOIs.
There are some that are. I couldn't tell you right now off the top of my head if it's 50-50, 60-40, or 80-20, but there are some that have the attachments included with the document.
I guess I'd like to see which ones those are because I'm not aware of them. I knew that there were some lengthy emails that had documents that were shown to the board, but they were actually documents shown to the board. They were not attachments, just lengthy emails. But I'm not aware that any of the attachments were actually printed with the FOIs.
So can I clarify, when you were looking through all the emails, after the IT person searched for them and you printed them out, are you saying that you don't recall seeing attachments?
That's correct. It would show an attachment, you know, just the icon for the attachment, but the attachment was not printed.
You didn't see any attachments?
No. Now, we can get those.
And perhaps maybe that's going to Attorney Mooney's point to get a clarification from what was the IT person's understanding as to how he was to conduct the search. Did he or she believe that he or she was only to come up with the emails and to ignore the attachments? You know, I think clarification would be helpful on that. So you believed that your FOI, that Ms. Stedman's FOI request included a request for attachments?
Yes.
I guess I read that to be any and all emails. I don't think emails necessarily means it includes the attachments. The attachments could be pages and pages long. It's my understanding that if the complainant wanted the attachments, they would then ask for them. We can produce them. Well,
at this point, perhaps you could ask Ms. Stedman if she could make a list of whatever attachments it is that she's looking for, because again, it seems clear at this point that the scope of this FOI request could have and should have been narrowed much, much more than it was. It seems to me that when now we're talking about attachments, there possibly could be many, 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 many attachments that have no bearing and no relevance to the complainant and what she's looking for.
Can we leave it at this? Jessica and I go back through the emails that we have, and there are attachments that we would like. Can we email and ask for just those specific attachments?
That would be a proper FOI request.
Yeah, I think that's what you should do. Do it now before, you know, while we're in this, right? So there...
I did last week, but I did not get a reply.
You did? You sent an FOI request for the attachments?
Oh, no, I just didn't send an email. Do you want me to do a separate FOI request for...
Leave that up to you guys.
I was out of state and then I was ill, so I didn't. I think I put an email stating that I wasn't answering emails for a while. So.
But to summarize, I believe you're saying you're going to look and see if you're interested in attachment the last time you did it.
Is that okay?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So I should just email both of you. If these are the attachments we're looking
Dr.
for,
Vogel.
Dr. Vogel, and you can email them to us.
Mm-hmm.
I can include the date
of
the email.
I need to know the date and the name of the email.
Yeah, like who it's the date and maybe the to and the from, so that we're all clear.
And we'll do that with all the previous FOIs and one going forward.
These four that is at issue here.
You want that for any any...
I believe the request will be fulfilled, and then the requesting party will say, well, I see there was an attachment. I'm interested in that attachment. There may be other emails where I'm not interested in that attachment. So we will be notified so that we can identify and send the attachments that are requested.
Okay. All the other emails, the attachments that Jessica or someone who's interested in versus people in the attachment. I don't know what's missing from the attachment, but I need to
Okay.
So we can conclude that the FOI request, this one, February 23rd through March 15th, that it's referring to, is possibly not complete at this time. So we still need to go to the personal email. Is that correct? Just want to make sure.
In which dates are we talking?
This one is February 23rd through March 15th.
I'm making a note of that. So.
And I think in line with that, also perhaps finding out from the IT person what the search parameters were, because we do have some evidence that perhaps an email was missed.
Yes.
He's, his assistant is, but he's out on surgery leave for about another week.
So I'm just home. What was the question? I was ready. I was making notes.
There's another FOI with emails, January 1, but they haven't started yet, so I thought maybe we should wait until
we
get clarification.
I see.
Before you print all
and the IT person is out?
But he's had surgery. He'll be back next week. But his assistant's working on some things, like for today.
Responding to the hearing, but as a person who has rights under the Freedom of Information Act, she's always free to ask Dr. Vogel questions.
Okay. And you'll let us know
that
you'll respond and let her know if you prefer this to be an official FOI request.
Mm-hmm. Does anybody want to say anything else on this case at this point?
Very briefly, the discussion here today has been helpful. Don't know if it appears to be the intent of the hearing officer that this case will be closed and a decision will be issued. And we would like an opportunity simply to provide some written explanation of our position as to whether and how we comply with the Freedom of Information Act.
So for your information, just because you're not a lawyer, under the Uniform Administrative Procedure Act, which is sort of the rules that we have these administrative hearings under, you are entitled to make a closing argument, just sort of summarizing what the evidence in the case was. But sometimes the parties would prefer to do that in writing, to send something in afterwards, and that's fine with me, and that is what Attorney Mooney is suggesting, I believe. So if you'd like to have that same opportunity to file something on Ms. Stedman, I mean, I don't know how she'd be able to do that, but you could do that on her behalf.
Okay.
And just kind of summarizing what you think the violation is, and I will consider that when I write the report.
How soon would you need that submitted?
This case was filed in April, right? April?
May. Because the requests were in April.
Oh, right. May. Yes, 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 yes. Well, I kind of would leave that up to you all. I know we have Thanksgiving and Christmas coming up. So.
Well, you're not.
This is
something short, right?
We're not going to need a month to do it.
Oh, it's short.
But in terms of timing, I'd suggest 3 weeks. That's, get us through Thanksgiving. And
do you have calendars with you?
I do.
Let's get a date.
Do you need my calendar too, or just yours?
No. Okay. It's just that we have, we're here, so 1, 2, 3. I would suggest December 10th.
December 10th, okay. Yes, at FOI@ct.gov, and make sure you copy the other side. And could we also come up with a date for these other sort of aspects that we talked about? So the IT person, how soon, Dr. Vogel, do you think that you could get the IT person to, you know, given that he's out sick, connect with him, explain what transpired at the hearing today, and get him to either write something about what his search, what his understanding of the search was and how he conducted the search, or explain it to you and have you do it? How long would you need to do that?
I think he could have that done in a week.
Okay. So we've got Thanksgiving.
Oh, that's right. We have so Thanksgiving. Maybe the following week.
So let's get a date.
Was there any problem with doing it simultaneously because you weren't considering the matter until you have the briefs? Could we include it as opposed to hearing the exhibit with the brief?
That's okay with me. Is that okay with you?
Is that going to mean that there won't be any activity on that last number one?
No. Okay. They're unrelated.
Well, they're not unrelated.
Well, what I mean
he
is
going to narrow it, correct? In terms of a search, and I still think I need to understand, are we narrowing
so it? I think the first step has to be that you need to consult with Ms. Stedman and find out whether she's willing to narrow the very broad scope of the request as it currently stands. In explicit terms, I think, you know, I agree with Attorney Mooney that the September 13th email wasn't probably as explicit as it could have been in terms of narrowing.
She
so,
had a reply. So mm-hmm. it, you know, she didn't understand that there mm-hmm. was any issue with that.
Yeah, sometimes there's a lot of miscommunication. But mm-hmm. could you, how soon can you provide that information to Dr. Vogel? I understand that she's having an emergency.
But I will try.
Okay, so maybe a week or so?
How about I'm providing it to my mom? What's today? Thursday.
Because Dr. Vogel needs that information mm-hmm. before they can start doing the search for the current
yes.
records, that's right? Great. For the current batch of fourth FOI request, right? Mm-hmm. And then we need to get a letter from the IT person, which Attorney Mooney is suggesting could be attached to the brief.
Stating how we did the search?
Yes. Yep.
And yes, specifically the methodology for the search that's been carried out to date, and whether that included personal emails.
Mm-hmm. And, yes?
Well, I guess just based on the fact that we were linking that to the narrowing, I was wondering if you were also asking for how he would be responding, how he would be doing the search based on the narrow terms. Is that was that the link between the narrowing, how the request is being narrowed?
Well, I think if the request is narrowed, if yep. we get confirmation that the request is going to be narrowed to block schedule.
Yep. And that would be the chart.
He would, I think probably we would need, you raise a good point. I want to know, what was his understanding of the parameter of the search with respect to the other three that he already completed? And then with respect to the fourth one, give us some information about how you're going to go about finding this emails that contain this phrase, block schedule. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, maybe. So, so I just want to clarify for myself so I know what we're waiting for and need to produce. Is what you're, what Ms. Cohn or Ms. Stedman are getting back to us on by Monday, just a narrowing of the scope of the block scheduling or a general narrowing of the requests?
The fourth FOI.
Just the one about the block scheduling.
Right.
Okay.
Yep.
And then we are producing the search terms for all of them or one in particular?
I don't understand the question.
The three are already completed.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
I'll ask for a list of
If she can come up with something in addition to or other than block schedule, that's great.
Can we also ask, could you look through your emails and see if something would come to your mind that you're talking about block schedule?
The prior emails.
Yes.
From the three other FOI requests, if there is something in there that discusses block scheduling and there's a phrase that's being used.
The only one would be block schedule, and it's already been, those have already been printed.
Well, there's stuff block. For, as an example.
Right, but those were already printed.
But in this current batch, what she's saying?
Block scheduling would be the best term. I don't think there will be any, but we can look. And if grading practices is another one, that's another. Again, if we just look for the word grading, we're going to get many, many, many. Mm-hmm. If we look for grading practices, are you looking more at the high school?
Yes, we're only interested in high school. But grading practices. Then you have to do grading policy and grading policies and grading practices to be able to get them.
The IT guy could probably answer that. Yeah. That you may not, you can't use like an exclamation point or something at the end so that it picks up all of that. But the other thing that we've talked about that we haven't nailed down is when would you, Dr. Vogel, be able to search your private email?
See, today I'm going to a conference and then Thanksgiving, probably in the next couple of weeks.
Could that be part of, Attorney Mooney, could that be part of your brief, part of your submission as
Certainly.
Well? An affidavit, perhaps,
right.
from the superintendent that she has, in fact, searched her private email and requested that the other board members also search their private email accounts. And to the extent that records are located, either provide them to the complainant, or if they need to be redacted, we can take that up as well.
Can they provide a statement that says we have searched, there are none, there are five, is that possible?
Here are the five?
Well, let me just pick the number.
The five emails? I think, I mean, for me, if Dr. Vogel can attest in an affidavit that she has spoken with each of these people and that they conducted a search, I don't need an affidavit from every single one of those people. I just need her to contact them, have them do the search, and then put this in the affidavit.
From my private email.
From your private email and their private email.
In other words, Mr. Whalen, you would say, Bob, at the FOI hearing, there was a question whether you have responsive emails on your personal email. Would you check?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Is there anything else that we did not get back to?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. I have two questions.
I do have a question. Are we talking specifically with these other individuals for any emails, or are we now narrowing the request?
That's a good question.
Well, I think for the FOI request that we think is completed, we go with what we did before.
The three requests?
No, the FOI request from February 23rd to
March. Oh, that's
March
the one you're most interested in.
10.
February 23rd, 2017 to March 15th, 2017.
Yes, for this one, I think go with any and all, because that's what you completed. This should be a 10-page. You know, we're not talking thousands, otherwise we hope not. For going forward, let's include that in the response from Ms. Stedman, whether she wants, yes. I'm going to answer that one. Going forward, we will narrow it down to the items in this statement produced to come
up. And just to, so far, but let me clarify further. If, in fact, Ms. Stedman comes up with a more, a narrower request, wouldn't it be logical to give the people who have to go search the benefit of that narrowing? Why would you ask these other people not to search their personal email on a broader scale when she said,
right,
these are my interests?
Well, but really, they're not supposed to be in according to the policy.
Oh, well, then that's fine.
I'll ask her if that's
okay. No. Okay. Yes.
I'll ask her.
Okay, so we're going to have Dr. Vogel search her personal account. She will ask the board members to search theirs, and the search will be limited if Ms. Stedman agrees to this block scheduling issue.
And the grading practices.
And grading policies or practices.
two options that I'm going to announce first. For February 23rd through March 10th, FOI request, if she wanted them to take you guys enough, or any and all. First, just in the personal email, as you provided with this FOI request otherwise. Going forward on the FOI that is left, if you want to restrict it to those, give us a list of works. Is that?
I would think that our board members give so much time anyway, and Bob Whalen, the board chair, will sometimes, you know, contact me about Habitat for Humanity. If we're asking him to go through every single email, and you're not interested in those, but you're interested in grading practices and scheduling, I think narrowing that search would be helpful for our board members.
I understand, but this should be, especially based on the policy, none. But I understand how we could use the wrong email address, staff and serving. It happens to me at work all the time.
But if I'm not emailing school business and I'm emailing them about something else, I use my own email. It could be about something not school.
No, definitely limited to regional business. Absolutely. I don't want to know about Habitat for Humanity. I mean, I can specify that for sure.
Well, if you're saying anything that's related to school, that's different.
Oh, absolutely. That's, yes, I'm sorry if I didn't make that clear. I don't need all your personal emails.
Okay, as long as you all understand what it is you're doing, we ought to get moving along here, because we have snow coming, and we're already 20 minutes into the next case, which was supposed to begin at 2:30. So anything that we talked about here today in terms of you getting... complaining, getting back to the respondents, responding's getting back. I'm going to leave that up to you. You guys figure it out. Put it in your brief, whatever. I think I've done as much as I can, as much as I can on this one. It's yeah.
May I ask some of the items that you asked me in the closing brief? Yeah. Can those be not part of the closing brief so we have a chance to respond to that? He's going to respond to the IT.
I'll make a determination based on what I see from the IT person. I will. I have to rule on this. These cases can't just go on and on like this. So you'll get my ruling. The hearing is going to be closed today, if that's your question. I'm going to close the hearing. I will. After the hearing, I will take the in-camera submission and look at those, make a ruling on those redactions as well.
So those are the 25 pages that were plus or minus from the last hearing that were discussed?
They're records that were withheld because the respondents believe they're exempt from disclosure. And you stated at the last hearing that you are contesting those redactions, which is why. Right. Okay. So with that, I'm going to close this hearing. It's 2:51. Okay. I'm going to go off the record just for a moment. This is a continued hearing in the matter of docket number 2018-0293, Jessica Stedman versus Regional Pam Vogel, Superintendent of Schools, Regional School District Number 1 et al. Today is November 15th. 2018. Time is now 1:05 p.m. My name is Kathleen Ross. I've been designated as hearing officer in this matter. For the record, the parties are here. And my notes reflect that when we last met, which was back in August, the hearing was left open for a couple of reasons. One was that the respondents were continuing to search for and review responsive records, and Attorney Mooney requested the opportunity to cross-examine or to ask the complainant some questions. And we talked about some an in-camera review as well. So I'm going to ask Attorney Mooney to start.
Certainly.
make whatever statement you want to make and proceed accordingly.
Well, yes, and thank you. We have continued the process of responding to the complaint. We have testimony in that regard.
Mm-hmm.
We also have reviewed the redacted records and identified, I think, 10 that were improperly redacted, and we have unredacted copies for the complainant. And to the extent that the hearing officer would also want a copy of those unredacted records, we could introduce those and make them part of the record. We also have identified records that, in respondent's view, were properly redacted, and we have an index for in-camera inspection.
So at this time, is the search and review of the responsive records completed?
It is not.
It is not.
There's one as the hearing officer may recall, there were thousands of emails to
yes.
review,
mm-hmm.
and that review has continued, and responsive records have been provided on a rolling basis,
mm-hmm.
But I believe the final request regarding emails is now the next step, but it's not completed at this time.
Okay. I'm going to, just for the record, Attorney Mooney's associate handed me a copy of the in-camera index with the records attached. We have a specific process for the submission of in-camera records, and we can do that after the hearing.
Fine.
But to the extent, well, I don't know how much evidence I would need. The redactions that are claimed pursuant to 1-210B10 and 1-210B17. To the extent you feel that you need evidence on the record, sometimes you don't, so I'll leave that up to you. But
yes,
you can do that today, too, as well.
I
neglected on my way in here to grab a notepad. So I'm going to have to turn off the recorder and just run and get one, and I'll be right back.
And Natalie, just to be clear on this, we have the redactions and then the unredacted versions follow. Okay. So this is so you can see what was redacted, but then you'll see in that graphic the unredacted emails.
Okay. Thank you.
And did you want to make
yeah, I think we should.
For the, to
yeah.
The record? Thank you.
Okay. So let's see where we left off. The numbering. All right, so for respondents, I believe we'd be at 4. Does that sound right? Respondents 4?
Respondent 4.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Any other preliminary matters? Anybody?
Not yet.
You all set?
On the board.
Ms. Cohen?
I'm sorry.
Any other preliminary matters that we should take care of before we begin the testimony?
No. Not that I have, no.
All right. Okay.
I call Dr. Volvo. To facilitate the questioning, we have supplementary exhibits that I'll be asking the witness to review,
mm-hmm.
and we have prepared a copy for the complainant and for the hearing officer, because these will be the records that are not currently in the record that I'll be reviewing with the witness.
Do you have a preference as to how these are marked? I could mark the entire thing as one exhibit, which...
I think that's the simplest because they are individually identified. So we would...
That's a great idea. So we could do respondents 5, A, B, C, D, E, F, G.
Yes.
Right, okay. Do you have any objection to me marking the exhibit that way? All right, I'm going to give you just a minute to review them and let me know whether you have an objection, Mr. Cohen.
And while that's occurring, what do you have as a respondent for?
That's the emails I just marked, the redacted and unredacted emails.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm all set.
Okay, good. So then if there's no objection to these, to what we're proposing to mark as 5A through J, I'll mark it as 5A through J.
Great.
That would be easy enough to track of. No objection?
Okay.
Thank you. So this packet is going to be marked as 5A through J. How will I describe these on the index in a short? Are they just emails? No, because there's a letter.
They're emails. There's transmittal letters of responsive records and cover emails. It's a bit of a challenge. I don't want to be repetitive, but it has been since August. And
yes.
So with your permission, I'll just ask some preliminary questions to set the stage out. And if I'm dwelling too long on repetitive information, I'm sure you'll...
I'll let you know.
Speak me up.
Okay.
Dr. Vogel, could you please identify yourself for the record?
I am the superintendent of schools at Region 1.
And I just want to remind you, you were sworn in at the last hearing, and you are still under oath.
Thank you.
And how long have you held that position?
I've been superintendent for a year and a half, and assistant superintendent for 2 years.
And Region 1 is composed of how many different boards of education?
We have 7 different boards of education.
And I bet you can name them from memory.
I can.
Okay.
Attorney Mooney, can you please try to keep your voice up?
Of course.
It's very, these blowers, and actually, you know what might be helpful too? I can turn this toward you.
Okay. Thank you.
Don't touch it.
Oh, don't touch it?
Because it will come out. I don't know if I know how to fix it.
Oh.
There you go.
Thank you.
Sorry.
And what are those boards of education?
The boards of education are Kent Center, Cornwall, Sharon Center, Salisbury Central, North Canaan, Leek H. Kellogg School, and then the Region 1 High School Board.
And you recall previously testifying in this matter?
Yes, I do.
And could you describe briefly your schedule in the summer around the time you received these?
I think we have all that, Attorney Mooney.
Okay. And has your schedule changed since that time?
When the school year was completed at the third week of June, it allowed me more time to work on these emails and the FOI request. There was a vacation time in the middle of July.
What about since the last hearing?
Since August?
Yep, August 2nd.
Well, we started school. At the second week, we started having administration team meetings, and then school began around the 25th for students. So we did spend the last 2.5-3 weeks very involved with just getting the school year started and getting teachers oriented. We had hirings that we also had to do. And then, of course, when school begins, it's always a bit, very busy year. But we have continued to work on the FOIs.
Okay. And why is it that you, as superintendent, feel it necessary to review the FOIs as opposed to delegating to someone else?
Well, the information that's in those FOIs, that are in the emails, I'm the only one that's familiar with those. I can't delegate that to my assistant because she's not aware of which names are students and parents and other confidential information.
And I believe in the prior hearing, you testified that you had reached out to Ms. Stedman after receiving her four FOI requests to see if you could agree on some narrowing of the scope of the request?
I did. I requested that.
And have you succeeded in that conversation to narrow or in any way limit the records that are requested in the four FOI requests that are subject to this hearing?
I received no response from her at that time limiting the request.
May I just again ask you to focus your questions, Attorney Mooney, and your answers on what happened since August 2nd. So since August 2nd, did you attempt to contact Ms. Stedman? Did Ms. Stedman contact you with regard to narrowing the scope of the request?
I did not contact her. A few weeks ago, she sent an email to me stating that she didn't appreciate getting copies of emails from certain administrators in our district. But when the FOI request came in, she requested that the FOIs involve any and all administrators in Region 1, and so that's what we did.
So is the answer to my question that the answer is no, Ms. Stedman did not attempt to contact you to narrow the search terms?
That's correct.
Since August 2nd?
That's correct.
Or ever?
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Since the hearing on August 2nd, did you review the charge for redaction that had been imposed for certain records? I think it was a $10 charge.
Yes, we did.
And what conclusion did you reach regarding the appropriateness of that charge?
Well, in consultation with you, our attorney, we discovered that several of those redactions were not correct. So we then issued a check. We are issuing a check for reimbursement for 10 pages for the total cost of $5. I believe it's $5.
Oh,
is that wrong? Maybe it's $10.
But they will stipulate
all right.
That it was $10 given Ms. Holmes.
I won't give
understanding.
You the interest
of time. Thank you. And let's separate two things. So you discovered that the charge was inappropriate and you have initiated a refund. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And second, in reviewing the redactions, you determined that some of those redactions were not warranted under the Freedom of Information Law.
Yes.
And those unredacted emails, emails that I provided earlier in this hearing, respondent four.
Yes.
Now, since August 2nd, have you continued your work reviewing emails and providing responsive records to Ms. Stedman?
I have.
And could I direct your attention, and this is now where we're catching up with the current time, to Respondent Exhibit 5A.
Wouldn't
it? It's no, it's A.
Oh, A.
Oh, A.
Thank you.
Well, it's in respondent 5.
Oh.
All right.
So, I'd like to just make the observation that these records speak for themselves, so we'll go through them pretty quickly. I don't want to prolong this unnecessarily, but So Friday, August 3rd, Dr. Vogel, did your, who is Tina Bunce?
Tina's my assistant.
And once you've reviewed the records, what do you do to get them to a requesting party?
I give those records to her. She makes a copy for our files, and then she immediately sends an email to the party and a letter from me stating the number of pages that have been reviewed and if there were any redactions, if they're available for her to either come and look at them or for us to give them to her at a charge.
And you referred to a letter. So we see in Respondents A, Respondents 5, letter A, your letter. And so in this particular case, you had reviewed an additional 127 pages?
That's correct.
Okay. And so as we go forward through this exhibit to number B, we see now August 24th. Is that the same? Did you follow the same process of further review, providing them to your assistant, who then conveyed them, made them available to the complainant in this case?
Yes, I followed the same process.
Okay, and so on August 24th, you made available 107
yes.
additional pages.
Yes.
And I note that you are in this letter saying that if Ms. Stedman is keeping the copies, there'll be a charge. But how has that worked in practice? Did you make these records available for inspection without charge?
We did. Anyone could come and inspect them at no charge.
And, in fact, did someone come in response to the letters under Respondents 5A and 5B?
I can't say for certain. Denise Cohn was generally the one to come in and inspect the records. I'm not certain at which time she came in, but my assistant is aware. She kept, I think, a documentation as to that.
Are you aware of any time that you've sent this letter and it's been ignored?
The last couple of times that we sent letters, just recently, no one came to review them until just a week ago, I believe.
Well, then they weren't ignored.
They weren't ignored, no.
All right. Okay. And turning to item C in Respondents 5, we are now September 11th, and there's, by letter, you're identifying 117 additional pages ready for review?
Yes.
And then September 21st, this is item D in Respondents 5. You identified an additional 108 pages?
Yes.
And then on October 1st, I see here that on your behalf, oh no, this is your letter. Could you please explain this letter under item E, dated October 1st, to Ms. Stedman, saying these are the final 43 pages?
That was the final 43 pages for that particular FOI request.
I see. And then we fast forward under item G to October 19th. And now this is responsive to a separate FOI request, one of the four that is the subject of this hearing.
That's correct, yes.
And in response to this request, did you identify responsive records?
Yes.
And I see here, again, you identified the number of pages ready for review, which was 56.
Right.
And in this case, these were not emails, per se. Is that correct?
They were emails.
Oh, they were emails. Okay.
This was the second part of, we had sent this FOI request was for agreements, payments made, and invoices to CABE and Baldwin, as well as emails. The agreements, payments made, and invoices were sent previously. This was now the emails.
Okay. Thank you for clarifying. And then moving on, we see October 29, an email conveying your letter to Ms. Stedman. Is this, I believe it's the same FOI request as was the case under item I? I'm sorry, under item G?
Yes. This was, these were additional pages that we had not yet reviewed, that I had not reviewed earlier, and okay. now was reviewing.
So as of October 29, you were identifying 53 additional pages?
In addition to the 56 before that, yes.
Yes, I see. And then turning to item I, this is another FOI request, and I see here this response is in regard to the second portion. So as you testified, you had provided the hard copy records, and now you've reviewed emails?
Yes.
And in this case, you had 69 additional pages reviewed and ready for inspection?
Yes.
Okay. And as part of this preparing for the reconvened hearing, did you prepare a log that with our assistance?
Yes, I asked my assistant to record the number of pages that we had reviewed, the number that had been redacted, the dates.
And just to identify, so does this log, and I believe you should have a copy here.
Yes.
So what we have here is identifying the different FOI requests and the status of those responses. Is that correct?
That is right. Correct.
And so apropos of a question the hearing officer asked at the beginning of the hearing, could I direct your attention to the last page, which is the fourth of the four FOI requests, which is now for any and all emails that were sent, CC'd, BCC'd, and on and on, between January 1, 2018 and April 10, 2018.
I have a different page than you.
Oh, how so?
My log is Denise Cohn, not Jessica. I think she has a different one as well. I don't think we have the same log.
Okay, well, we can fix that.
Region 1D, Cohn, FOI response.
Okay, so that's a mistake.
Okay.
We have, as this will come up in the other hearing.
A little bit later.
You want
Correct.
To swap that out?
I do.
I'll just give you back that.
Okay.
Give you back
yeah, for now. We'll be back to it. And thank you for noticing.
Yes, I was just noticing.
Well.
I was trying to cheat and look over on you.
Well, for now, we can
here,
just...
I can share time.
The superintendent has a copy.
Yes, so we'll share, and then we'll provide this other copy to Ms. Cohn. Thank you. And this is for the hearing officer, and that literally is, we offer that as Respondents 5, Item J, and we just had the wrong one in there.
Okay,
so... Now that we're all on the same document, Dr. Vogel, could you please identify the last entry here, 4. Does that correlate to the fourth FOI request?
It does.
And it's described here.
Mm-hmm.
And we may need some help from Attorney Wagner. The strike through for Stephanie Rafferty?
She is no longer on the board. I'm not certain if we should. I can still produce those. That was she just left the board a month or two ago.
I see, but you've not We have gone through your testimony as to the progress to date on this email review.
Right.
And is this next on your agenda?
It is.
And could you estimate for the hearing officer the number of emails that are involved?
Several thousand. That's a four-month period.
By and between?
January 1.
How many members are on the Region 1 Board of Ed?
There are six.
So that we have six people, seven, or are these the members?
The members, and then it's also myself and the assistant superintendent.
So we have emails by and between eight people for a period between January 1, 2018 and April 10, 2018?
Correct.
And there's no limiting criteria. It's just any and all emails.
Yes.
Among those persons. And your estimate is that there are several thousand emails?
I would guess, yes.
And is it your plan to review those emails and continue the process of responding?
That's my plan, yes.
I had to give me two copies. If you want to follow along.
Well, thank you. So that can go back in your book.
Okay.
I have no further questions at this time.
Before I let you jump in, Ms. Collins, I want to make sure I understand your references on this response log that you provided. So somewhere in your paperwork, you gave the request numbers. So what I have is copies of the requests that were submitted. How? I guess I can just go by the dates.
No, they're all
the dates that the requests that the emails are requested for.
They're all the all four requests were dated.
Numbers, where did those numbers come from? I'm just wondering.
They're just references, just so that you can tell that there's four of them. But really, you would be able to tell from the description of what the request.
Right.
Is.
Right.
So.
That's okay. The only way.
Yeah. Okay. But, just go by the dates of the requested emails. So the one that you're calling number four is what is. Appears in my packet as the third request, but I can match them up by using January 1, 2018 through April 10, 2018. Okay, so that was one question I had. And then I didn't quite follow your testimony regarding why there's a person's name is crossed off on the list.
I can ask you a question.
Please.
Did you receive any similar requests around the same time period as the one that you're
looking at here? I'm
sorry,
say that again.
Okay,
you
have to speak up.
Don't touch.
Yeah, don't touch. Don't touch. If you have, definitely that's the way to
slide
it. Is to just pick it up by the base. If you pull this, it will break or it will come off and then I won't be able to figure out how to get it back on. So that wouldn't be good. Okay, so you all can share this microphone.
So the question that I was asking was whether you received any similar requests from any other individuals in the same time period that this request, you received this request?
No, I did not receive any others. I guess I'm not certain, but I'm not certain that Stephanie Raftery was even mentioned in these initial requests. She was on the board only for a few months.
Oh, so in other words, someone added her name, because I am looking at the request, and I don't see her name on there.
Let me ask it a different way.
Or let's just offer a stipulation.
Okay.
And see if that works.
Yeah, that would be good. What's the deal with having this name crossed off?
So that was because we have two related hearings that are back-to-back, and some of them involved very similar requests. This was one, actually, that was very similar, but for a name that appeared in one and not in the other. So it was just an indication that in the one from Ms. Stedman, that name was not mentioned, but in the other one, it is. So We're just trying to keep track of the differences.
Oh, so it was a way for you, because you could have just deleted it.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
Which is what we normally do in the technological age, but it was just a reference for you to know that if it's crossed off, then that must be Jessica Stedman's as opposed to Denise Combs. Okay. All right. Thank you for that explanation. So how are you able to estimate the number of emails? Has IT done a preliminary search?
This is the most extensive search yet in terms of the time period. So there was another search of one of these FOI requests involved, I think, a three-month period. And when he brought me the emails, he said there are at least 1,500 to 2,000 here.
And that was for a three-month period.
Yes.
And this is for a four-month period.
Well, 3 months and 10 days. January, March to April 10th. Am I looking at the right one?
Okay, 3 months. So I believe it's the longest period of time of the FOS.
April 10th. Just over 3 months. And your estimate is how many?
Anywhere between 1,500 and 2,000 probably.
What's the time, what is the timing looking like for you in terms of your ability to get through those?
I try to get to at least 100 every week when possible.
So maybe by the end of the year?
That's not much further.
No, that's true. We have holidays. Yeah.
It probably will be a little longer than that.
Break, right? Thanksgiving break and Christmas break. Thank you. Ms. Cohn, sorry. Do you have any questions for the superintendent?
I have several. And I just wanted to point one thing out on this exhibit.
Which exhibit are you referencing?
5A-J?
Yes.
On the letter under G.
G.
The last paragraph, also as a reminder, we still have the last two badges.
Oh, yes, I do.
Mm-hmm. On the next letter, under H, you'll see the same exact paragraph. That was a mistake. They had been picked up. Tina just forgot to delete that from her form. But don't you think this is going to sit there?
Okay, so it is your testimony that, so you don't dispute that on October 19th that there were three batches of emails that hadn't been picked up?
Yeah.
And when the superintendent says an alternative FOI request, how did you interpret that?
I'm sorry?
I can ask the superintendent herself. I'm just curious. As a reminder, we still have the last three batches of emails from an alternative FOI request.
From a different FOI request.
I see. Perhaps yours.
Okay. Not mine, but I think it was from a different FOI request
that Ms. Stedman had made.
Yes.
That is not the subject of this hearing.
It is the subject of the hearing.
It is. My only point in that was that this last paragraph is a repeat by mistake. She just used the same format.
Yep. So perhaps I could have the superintendent clarify. I don't want evidence in this case that doesn't belong. So if you could explain to me, I guess maybe you can just answer the question without sort of getting into the specifics of this letter. Were there batches of emails that were responsive to the request that's at issue today that were not picked up or were picked up later than perhaps you might have expected?
Yes, there were.
Okay, and is that what this reference means?
That is that reference. And she did probably inadvertently put it in two letters, but there were three batches of emails before the fourth one was picked up.
Yeah, but why would you use the phrase, I'm a detail-oriented person, probably sometimes to my own detriment, but why use the phrase an alternate FOI request? I'm not understanding what that is.
And that was probably her language, not mine, but she meant that there were three other batches from a different FOI request, not this one, not the one referenced in this letter, that have not been picked up yet.
Can I just clarify?
Please.
There are four FOI requests by the same person.
Yes.
I believe the reference is we're dealing with this one, but remember we have three that we haven't picked up from this other one.
Okay.
But they're all complainants, FOI requests.
Right.
Is that?
That's correct.
All right. Okay, thank you. Okay, so that was October 19th. There were records that hadn't been picked up. And the complainant is trying to point out that in the in H, tab H, that language appears again.
Yes.
And the complainant is disputing that as of October 29th, there were batches of records that hadn't been picked up at that point.
We have no reason to contradict the complainant's clarification of the record.
Okay. Okay. And Ms. Kong, were you the person that was presenting yourself at the offices of the of this respondent to look at these records?
Yes. One of them. But mostly me, yes.
Mm-hmm. And why didn't you go and pick up or review the records that were provided?
We were only allowed to go in between 8 and 4:30 and I had to go figure out work, and I was away. So there was a slight delay.
So office hours are, don't work with your work hours. Yeah, that can be a problem for people, I think. Okay. Would you like to ask some more questions,
yes.
Ms. Koh? Please proceed.
On the exhibit with the log, on the first page under item 2 on the responses, on June 28th it says reviewed 1,000 pages, and just before that it says 650 pages, and just before that it says 500 pages. But that is included in the 1,000 pages. You hadn't reviewed 2,250 pages. When we went down there, I think it was the 29th, there was only 1,038 pages there. Is that correct?
Which one are you referencing?
On this very first page, where you have the logs, the response logs. On June 28th, it said 1,000 pages. Before that is 650 pages, and prior to that is 500 pages.
Mm-hmm.
But that 1,000 is actually total and includes the 650 and 500. It's not an additional.
Well, that's why it has the word total.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
I believe so.
Well,
that's how I would interpret it. Total? Right. So the first one says indicating 500 pages available. The next one says a total of 650 have been reviewed. Total of 1,000 have been reviewed. Then we have additional pages.
Okay. All right. Mm-hmm. Then mine.
Well, I mean, I think it's a good question. I think it could be subject to differing interpretations, but I think the answer is that that's the total.
Okay.
Right?
Yes.
Dr. Boyle, you testified that you had not heard anything from Jessica as far as narrowing her scope. She sent an email to you on September 13th reminding you of a conversation she had in May. Do you want me to give a copy now?
Certainly.
It's on the back page of this one. And I'm sorry, as much as I remember to make three pages, I should have made four.
You did pretty well. Some people don't bring any guts.
Okay, so it starts out with Peter Pam. This is right after the hearing we have. She's reminding you that when he spoke to you back in May, that her focus was scheduling and grading as well as involvement. And that's what she was looking at. She clarified the administrators. She did not receive a response to this email, but she was clearly stating that you and her spoke about this in May, and again, she's sending you an email in September. But you just testified that you had not received anything from Jessica.
I did testify that I had received an email from her later this fall, which was September, stating that she only wanted information on grading practices and Ann Baldwin. But she did not narrow her request when I first asked in a letter, would she narrow her request? There was no response. I do not recall her speaking to me in May. If she did, I have no recollection of that. She references that in this email. I do not remember speaking with her in any way. And she also, this was the one I just mentioned earlier, where she stipulated that she only wanted to hear from certain administrators in the emails, but in her FOI request, her information that she asked for is for any and all Region 1 administrators, which include these that she's now saying she doesn't want to hear from.
Okay. In the FOI request that includes administration that you said is complete, did you include any emails from administrators such as Carl Burson, Merrick, or any of them?
They are Region 1 administrators.
Were they included in this FOI request or emails from Region 1 administrators?
Yes.
There are no emails in that packet.
I generally...
Carl Burson, Sam Merrick, they were not in that, in okay. that packet.
Well...
I'm going to ask you, have you moved on from this September 13th?
No.
Okay, because what was that? I'm not sure what.
Dr. Vogel testified that she included.
There were some emails. Okay, excuse me.
She has to say.
Okay.
Stated that she had included emails from Carl Gross, other administrators, and the FOI packet of emails.
So you're saying that there's a reference in the September 13th email. Can you point to where you're reading from?
At the hearing. Just to clarify as an example.
At the hearing, you also stated you had asked me for keywords to sort by. When we spoke in May, it was clear that the main focus was schedule and grading policies as well as Ann Baldwin's involvement. As I also mentioned on the phone in May, I cannot pinpoint any specific words as I'm not aware of the conversations which took place in the emails or the sheer number of emails exchanged. Certainly, I was not asking for the same copies of the same emails in several batches. Seeing how you're personally printing and redacting, it would be obvious to everyone's message which you not continually duplicate what you have been doing in every batch. Okay, but what, where
previous paragraph, she states that she's not looking for emails from any administrators other than those mentioned above, which is within this.
Okay, but why were you pointing me to the paragraph that I just read?
To correspond on the hearing you had mentioned.
Yeah.
Staff. I just asked Dr. Vogel.
Oh, I'm sorry. So I read the wrong paragraph.
Well, you started it with the right words. What? But then you skipped. Oh, no. You know what? It's the same.
Exactly. Sorry. Okay, yeah. So let's get back on track here. So what you wanted me to look at is the paragraph that reads, at the hearing you mentioned other staff, which were technically administrators. I'm not looking for emails from any administrators other than those mentioned above. Again, I've never been asked to clarify that question either. Okay, and what would you like, what point would you like to make about that? Does that, in your mind, does that sentence that I just read, does that narrow the request?
Well, it depends on how it is interpreted.
Is it your position that the complainant in fact narrowed her request subsequent to the August 2nd hearing in this matter?
Prior to and since?
Nope.
Yes.
Just since August 2nd,
yes.
When we were here,
yes.
Talking about perhaps the complainant didn't understand the volume of records that were involved. So is that the purpose of pointing out, is that the purpose of this September 13th email? Does this, in your mind, does this show... Are you arguing that this shows that the complainant narrowed the request?
Yes.
Okay. And where does that say that? What request is being narrowed, and where does it say that the request is being narrowed?
It answers the question Dr. Vogel had at the hearing in August as to whether or not Jessica was looking for administrators other than what is it?
Okay. So that's the only portion of the email that you're arguing constitutes a narrowing of the request?
No, the next paragraph also does. She makes it clear that her main focus was scheduling, grading practice, as well as Baldwin's involvement, which she is reiterating from a previous conversation.
Okay. So, Dr. Vogel, when you received, did you receive this email?
I did.
So, apparently, based on your prior testimony today, you didn't interpret this email as a narrowing of the request?
No, because we'd already gone through all the emails. And when I first asked her in my response, when I received the four FOI requests, would she narrow her request? there was no response. So we printed all the emails that included any and all administrators, which does list these people that she's saying I didn't want to hear from. They are Region 1 administrators.
Okay, but well, I'm going to stop you right there. But there's an FOI request today that we know of that you have not started working on, correct?
Correct.
We
could narrow based on that.
Okay.
But what I've already gone through, that's almost past history now. Because her grading practice request is, well, we can go on with it.
Grading practice request had been completed prior to August 2nd?
Much of it has.
What about between August 2nd and today?
This email came in September.
Okay. What about since September 13th? Between September 13th and today?
I continued with the same process that I was doing.
Why is that?
Because they were already printed and I would have had to have gone through and sorted out, and I could have sorted out which ones. We didn't charge because she came in to look at them. I'd already redacted anything that needed to be redacted, and I reviewed everything.
Okay, so by the time you got this on September 13th, you had already done all that work?
Everything had been printed for me to start reviewing.
So going forward, with respect to the remainder of the review process, is it possible that you can make your workload a little bit lighter by using, I mean, maybe the complainant could clarify here today what specifically what search term she's looking for, but would that help you to?
It could, yes.
Can you speak on behalf of the complainant? Can you
tell
us today what search? You're here as a representative.
I don't know that I can give specific search terms, but I can reiterate that it is.
Yeah. What is she looking for?
Grading practices, schedule, and involvement in
Region 1. So emails that would talk about
within. Yes, she has asked for emails or invoices, but relating to scheduling, grading policies, and involvement.
Scheduling of what?
They've changed the schedule at the school from. It was not well taken by the community and the parents.
So you understand when she uses the term schedule, you understand what that means?
Yes, but that was a year ago. That's kind of past history now, so there probably aren't a lot of emails related to that topic. But just looking for the word schedule could still produce thousands of emails because we talk about schedules all the time in many emails.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not sure that's going.
Yes, please.
This email uses the phrase, I was pretty clear that the main focus was the schedule and grading policies as well as involvement in well-being. We have an opportunity today to add definition to those terms and leave here with a clear understanding as to what is being requested and what's not being requested. But I don't think that if a person says I'm pretty clear that the main focus is something that would constitute a modification of the freedom of information request, which was submitted in a very formal way.
Mm-hmm.
So we would appreciate any further narrowing or clarification.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't, and Dr. Wallace testified, she didn't read this as a formal modification of the freedom of information request.
Mm-hmm.
And what is this marked?
We haven't marked it. Is there any objection to having
no
it marked?
No objection.
Yeah. So let's mark that as complainants G. So, Ms. Cohen, this would be a good opportunity for you to provide the respondents and me with some clarification of as to what Ms. Stedman is really looking for.
May I ask a question?
Yes.
Did you reply to this email and ask Ms. Stedman to clarify?
No, I did not.
I think it's you can say that Ms. Stedman is looking for information on the schedule at Hoosie. It refers to the WAC schedule and the changes in the proposed change.
What? Hoosie?
In the
Valley
Regional High School. Sorry.
Okay.
Grading policy and the involvement.
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess it would. I guess Dr. Vogel will have to talk to her IT people and see whether there is a way to. I mean, you must know there must be some way that this schedule change is referenced.
The change is done. It was done a year ago. So there aren't many references to the schedule anymore. But the word schedule will show up in many emails just because of the nature of the word.
May I ask a clarifying question? Would it be acceptable if they were to search by the term block schedule or block scheduling? Because I think that would narrow the hits that you would get.
Would that include emails that are referencing the schedule?
And I could tell you there would be no emails coming up with that word in it.
With the phrase block schedule?
That's correct, in this time period. It was discussed a year and a half, 2 years ago. It hasn't been discussed in any emails that I'm aware of in the last 6 months.
There are references to the schedule in that time period. I didn't bring that stack with 1,000 pages, but I may have one.
I'm talking about this year, in January, in 2018, in the FOI that has not been fulfilled.
The schedules have never been discussed. It's never been a hot topic.
Maybe for you, but it hasn't been for everyone, and it hasn't been in any of my emails.
I don't know if I can answer that.
Certainly.
Mm-hmm. A reasonable amount of time. I'll ask her.
Mm-hmm.
Or if there's any other term that Ms. Stedman feels might capture what it is that she's looking for, we could ask her.
I mean, I'd like to rely on Dr. Vogel. We haven't seen it yet. How is it referenced?
It hasn't been a topic of discussion since we abandoned the idea over a year ago.
Would it be helpful if you looked back at prior emails to see how? What phrase was used to discuss
block scheduling would have been the discussion, but that conversation ended in early 2017.
With a decision not to
do it. To do it, that's correct. Again, I'd have to do a search. We can do a search in that term, but I guarantee that emails that have been sent to me and from the board do not contain that word.
Well, if you're in your Gmail and you type in the word schedule in the search bar, pretty privately, it'll show anything that says the word schedule.
We talk about my schedule, someone's schedule. The word schedule will come up in many, many ways. Block schedule will not.
Ask her. Mm-hmm. Ask her. Because if this truly is what she's looking for, it's a waste of everybody's time for the superintendent to go through thousands of emails about topics she's completely not interested in. Would you agree?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'll ask. But
yeah.
Let me ask her.
Okay. Further questions, Ms. Cohn?
Yes.
Please proceed.
The FOI request from February 23rd through March 15th, 2017, has been completed. February 23rd through March 15th, 2017, has been stated that it has been completed. Dr. Vogel, do you use your personal email address for Region 1 business?